Good afternoon, my name is Jim Conlan and welcome to the latest episode of our entertainment show. As you know, we've been previewing and premiering on air for the last month or so about our new fight game sort of documentary in terms of the fighting franchise that has been turned into a global mess. So in the past, we've done these types of documentaries. We did one in Street Fighter in 2019. We also did a documentary on Mortal Kombat in 2020. The Mortal Kombat documentary, as people are very much aware, included 39 episodes and was nominated as the best Mortal Kombat documentary or news project in Mortal Kombat in the last 20 years. We had everyone from Michael J. White to Joel McHale to Chris Casamassa, to name a few throughout the documentary. But this month and this year, is our feature is definitely Tekken in the third sort of installment. So you had Capcom with Street Fighter in the early 90s, then you had NetherRealm Studios with Mortal Kombat. And the last player into the game then was Namco with the Japanese company with their version of Tekken. And my guest this evening has been synonymous with one of the pioneers of the Tekken sort of franchise, the character Paul Phoenix. He has played Paul since really 2007 and possibly even earlier than that, dating back at into Tekken 6 in 2007. He was also involved in Tekken 7 in terms of the character Paul Phoenix. He was involved in a Tekken Tag Tournament in 2011 where he voiced the character of Paul Phoenix as well. And most he was in the fight crossover game between Street Fighter and X and Tekken in 2012. And in the latest now animated series, he's voicing the character of Hayachi Mishima in Tekken Blood Vengeance. But I just want to talk to you, first of all, Jamieson. You're a renowned sort of voiceover actor. I've seen so many credits, so many roles that you have done, just looking up that your resume. Tell us about Tekken and how it came to pass to you. Because I remember speaking to Leslie the other day, and she actually was living in Japan at the time when Tekken came out, when she got first involved in 2001 with the Nina Williams character. Your journey is probably maybe a bit later than that, and how, or is it around the same time? And if so, how did the opportunity come about for you to get first involved in Tekken?
Well, it was auditioning for the role. This was probably back 2006, 2007. It was Tekken 6, I think, Bob's Ending, that I first voiced Paul. And it was just one of the studios that I work with here in LA. And I got the opportunity to audition and got selected for the role.
And I suppose, Jamieson, at that time, Tekken, as Leslie was said, it had made the move across from Japan to the United States in terms of in the early sort of 2000s in terms of its base. And you had done numerous sort of animated games and character role games. Is this your first venture into the fight game sort of franchise?
Oh, no. Let's see. Super Street Fighter 4, I was a narrator in that, and something else. So it's right. I guess I didn't start Mortal Kombat until 2009. So Tekken was before that. So it was, I guess, one of the first ones that. But I was known for the big aggressive kind of voice characters. So it fit right into my wheelhouse.
And Jamieson, in terms of the Paul Phoenix sort of character, obviously animated sort of video games at the time, and obviously the Tekken were trying to create him a new character. What you sort of go off in terms of these characters? Is it the pictures, the drawings, what sort of costume they sort of wear in terms of how you're going to project their sort of voice? Or is it the sort of background story? Do they give you certain things? Well, we think this guy is Australian. We think he's going to be between the demographic of 24 to 36. His main hobbies are this, this, and this. And you can sort of check, sort of, well, go through your head and say, well, maybe this is the way I'm going to pitch it, or I'm going to raise my voice and for certain decibels, or I'm going to put a sort of twang in it. Or how does it actually go about? Are the drawings the most important thing for you?
For me, I think visually, I'm a visual guy. I like to see what the character looks like, and then I can imagine how he's going to sound. I can't recall, but I'm pretty sure there was an original Japanese actor that I could hear and listen to. So we always take that into account when we're localizing a project, anime or video game. We're going to listen to the original actor and try to get an idea of what the director was going for. And then there's the visual, but there's also description, certainly, like you said. And there are times when you don't have artwork and all you have to go by is description and a little biography and kind of, all right, try to figure out what it is. And as actors, we come up with, you know, some ideas and start throwing them around, and the director will help us kind of narrow that down to what the actual character voice is that they want to hear in the game.
Yeah. And in terms of Paul's sort of character and the sort of backstory, and as the game sort of developed throughout the years, as you know yourself, the storylines in those animated games become sort of mini movies. They become standalone sort of features. I was only speaking to Leslie the other day. I remember we did the Mortal Kombat one and documentary, and Mortal Kombat X, when I was looking back at it, if you took out actually the fight scenes and just played it on its own, I remember someone had put it up on YouTube and it got over 2 million views alone, but they actually put it up, they just cut out all the different fight scenes and just played it as one big animated movie. It was over 3 hours and 45 minutes long. Wow. In terms of that sort of, in terms of dialogue and content. But that's the way the games are sort of going in terms of these characters. They're always becoming like mini sort of TV series or mini sort of episodes for each sort of character. So in terms of Paul's sort of involvement throughout the years, this is in terms of dialogues, has it sort of surprised you a bit in terms of the content? Is it coming more and more and more?
It doesn't surprise me. I mean, I began to do voices in video games when the storage capabilities got big enough to start having actual dialogue and not just grunts. So it was kind of way back at the beginning of the cinematic quality of voice acting in video games. And it just keeps getting better and more nuanced. And I am amazed and surprised at how fast and how well it progresses. That, you know, each new thing that comes out, everybody's trying to top themselves. And so that's fun and surprising to see.
I suppose, Jamieson, back in the early days, obviously starting off with Tekken, and obviously back in baby Tekken 6 in 2007, back then in those days, it was all about the one-liners in terms of the fight scene. Every character had his own sort of one-liners in terms of different persons and different sort of finishers or different way sequences coming into the fight. And they were the sort of catchphrases for each sort of character in terms of how they were going to disembowel or how they were going to basically wipe the person off the face of the planet as sort of such. So in sort of those sort of lines as such, they are almost become iconic. And do you sort of different ways on how you want to emphasize those sort of lines in terms of Paul's character?
Well, we work with the director. The director will ask for different emphasis. We will do multiple readings of each line. So, you know, somewhere out there are different readings of all those different lines and catchphrases. And then they pick the ones that they like the best. And not only the director, but I'm sure, you know, the client, the IP holder, intellectual property, rights holder has an opinion, and they throw it in there too. So it's a lot of people going into making that whole project come to life.
And Jamieson, obviously you're involved now with Tekken Blood Vengeance that's out at the moment, and obviously it's an animated sort of TV sort of series, a cartoon type sort of series on Tekken, and obviously that's based on sort of plot, a beginning, a middle and end in terms of a storyline. Do you enjoy the animated sort of cartoons when you see these characters go from what is was standalone Basham's arcade video type characters where you put in your quarter in the 90s and you hit as many buttons as you can and you come out with sort of sore fists and sore thumbs, but it's almost worthwhile and those sort of memories. Now you're almost looking at them as sort of like Simpsons characters.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's always fun as an actor to tell a story. And you can tell that story with one line, but when you have more lines to tell that story, it's somehow easier or more satisfying. So getting to tell a longer story and to do backstory on these characters and to develop them further on their little narratives. That's a lot of fun. Yeah, I do enjoy that more than just the one-liners.
Yeah. And in terms of being involved in the Tekken sort of franchise, and obviously it's a global, obviously the gaming community is massive, and especially with fight games, it's almost like fight games and car games have their own sort of unique sort of global fan base, like your Gran Turismo's in Asia and the Middle East, massive. But what struck me about Tekken is it's not only the USA, it's not only Japan, obviously, it's not only the UK and Australia, but this sort of universe and Tekken universe, it spread to the Middle East, it spread to North Africa, places like that you wouldn't suspect would have a massive sort of Tekken sort of fan base in terms of the youth sort of generation. And has that sort of surprised you when all these conventions and Comic-Cons come along and you sort of, you're there, but maybe you might have gone to one or two on behalf of sort of Tekken, and you see people coming up and chanting or preaching your one-liners back to you, or dressing up or costumes in terms of sort of Tekken? Does it start to take you by surprise when you see people of all walks of life?
Yeah, it's a little surprising. You never know what's going to hit and what's going to go global like that. So it's surprising and fun and lovely when that happens and you are touching people all over the world and they're getting something out of it and bringing something back to you at a convention, and you know, they're coming in cosplay or shouting out the catchphrases. It's a wonderful community.
Yeah, and obviously fan mail can come from all over the world. I remember speaking to Leslie just there a few days ago, and she actually said Tekken had a massive fan base in Saudi Arabia of all sorts of places, that it was absolutely huge over there. And in terms of your sort of maybe fan mail that came through your door from Paul Phoenix, is it truly global? Is it truly universal? Is there obvious sometimes where you might have got comments from Argentina or Brazil or places like that make you sort of scratch your head and say, wow, they've actually played Tekken in Rio de Janeiro and places like this?
It is amazing, the global reach of it. Yeah. It's gone to the far corners of the world. It's amazing.
And I suppose in terms of Tekken now and seeing its transformation to the big screen, obviously when the blockbuster movie came out in 2010, in terms of the fight sequences, had you sort of high hopes of maybe Paul's involvement and maybe Paul having a big role to play within that movie and being able to see him on the TV screens and see a character that you had sort of found and created? And were you a bit disappointed when you saw maybe Jin and Brian Fury and Yoshimitsu and all these characters maybe getting the highlights in terms of their sequences of the movie? We were thinking to yourself, I want to hopefully see more of the character I played so many years to get him to see on a big international stage in terms of a global premiere, which the Tekken movie was in 2010.
Well, you always hope that that your character is going to see more action, see more screen time, because then you get to play, you get to work and to have fun and to make a living. So, yes, it would be great to see Paul more featured in different things, but it's hard to begrudge, any telling of the story in any way, just to, you know, get it out there and popularize the product and reach more people.
And obviously, Tekken, as it came, it's obviously with the PlayStation and the Xbox sort of market, and so unique and so cornerstone to that. But obviously, modern technology means modern devices. And we saw when games hit a truly global sort of audience, the demanding comes from the fan base for a TV series, for a movie, a sort of such. Just like Mortal Kombat X, when it came out in 2017, people said, a movie's got to come, and sure, lobby, because the fan base wanted it. It came in 2020. Do you think Tekken is maybe that one game away now from having a similar sort of story in Mortal Kombat? Because in fairness to Tekken, when it did come out in 2010, the movie was deemed an adequate success. It wasn't deemed a bust like what Street Fighter, that movie, which came out in the 90s, which people said, which frightened Capcom of ever going into the big screen again. Like, you know, it's like Mortal Kombat seemed to have got it and made that transformation. Tekken have tried it, and it came down to good enough sorts of success. So do you think Tekken would be brave to go and try it again?
We'll see. Movie making is a risky business. And yeah, once you get burned, the investors are like, whoa, I don't know about that. But I hope that it gets a movie. It'd be great to see. It'd be great to have it out there. And it could be, yeah, one small step away from making that that transition, I hope.
Yeah, and I suppose in terms of being advised and airing these sort of characters, and obviously now you're going in an animation sort of TV series with Tekken at the moment. And so sometimes in that sort of series, I spoke to Vivian about this. In game sequences, you're quoting lines and one lines, and you possibly to the one person that you're up with, that you're fighting against on the sort of TV screen. In animated TV series, that you could be in sequences where there's three or four sort of characters, and you could be talking, mentioning one line to one character, they might come back to you, then another line facing the other way to another character. Do you almost feel like that you've turned in the boot and look left and right to sort of get to sort of sequences and say to yourself, or can you stand pitch sort of perfect with no one in attendance when you're doing, is it different animated voiceovers to compare to video games voiceovers? Is there a bit of a twist to it? Is it more challenging in terms of you're preparing dialogue and you say, right, this person's lying wait, and then you realize you got to go again, but you might be talking to someone else or someone's different, then your sort of mood might be different. So is that sort of challenging as sort of, or the fight sequences where you're just banging out those one-liners, those one lines in terms of different one-to-one interactions?
Not really. It's pretty much the same in that... You have to stay on axis with the microphone. Your mouth has to be in the same orientation to the microphone, or your engineer is going to make you do it again because they didn't capture the sound properly. So we're very careful about making sure that we stay on mic. That being said, yes, there's physicality in the booth. I have training as a fighter. And so I'm blocking and punching and doing stuff, trying to make sure that I maintain that orientation to the microphone, but being very physical about it as I'm working in the booth. If there's another person that I'm going to talk to, I'm going to switch them in my mind. It's going to be an imagination thing. I really can't go, oh, I'm going to talk to you now because now I'm off mic. And then the engineer's like, hey, come back. So I'm still maintaining, you know, my orientation with a microphone and talking to this imaginary person or fighting with this imaginary person. But the next one that comes along, we're going to bring them right in my mind, they're still going to be in the same place, if that makes sense.
And in terms of those sorts of shooting days, and obviously with animated sort of series, in terms of memory sort of retention, do you almost like break it up where you sort of go in sort of sequence sort of mode just to give you that time to just get a bit of water, a bit of rest, to have a look over again? Because obviously if you're churning out line after line after line in different animation sequences, it can be sort of that retention is different to, there's not much in retention, I imagine, in a video game compared to animation sort of series.
It depends on the cinematics in the video game. Sometimes there's a lot of narrative in there and we do want to go through it almost chronologically. The thing about voice acting is that you, especially in video games, can blow your voice out. So we tend to save the big battle cries, screams, and large efforts towards the end. They don't have the same nuanced meanings that words do. So we get the words out of the way first. We tell the story. We get it where we wanted to get to. And then we start blowing our voices out with yeah, and all sorts of battle cries and yells and things.
I suppose, Jamieson, one last question for you now, and thanks for sharing your time with us today. And let's pretend there was a Tekken encyclopedia as such, and all the fictional characters of Tekken was put into that encyclopedia throughout the year. And they came down to letter P, and they came down to the character Paul Phoenix. And under his description, his synopsis as such, they left two blank sentences. And the talent agents of the came across to you and they said, listen, Jamieson Price, you've been so heavily involved with Paul Phoenix since his beginning of Tekken. Mm-hmm. We would like you to write those two sentences to summarize what the character Paul Phoenix was like and what he stood for. What would you like those two sentences to read?
Oh, I think that he stood for, you know, honor and strength and effort. I mean, no pain, no gain. And Paul's been there and done that.
On that note, Jamieson Price, an absolute pleasure to talk to you today. Thank to you. Relive your memories of vicing Paul Phoenix in Tekken Bloodline, obviously vicing his role in Tekken 6, in Tekken 7, in Tekken Tag Tournament, and also in Street Fighter versus Tekken. And no doubt, many more to come down through the years as well. We look forward to it. It's great to see Tekken now in terms of this animated series. We hope it goes very well for you and that there's many more seasons for it to come and obviously more projects down the line in terms of Tekken and your involvement as well. But for the moment, Jamieson Price, take care and God bless.
Thank you, Jim. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.